Hey, horse people. Hopefully Moki won't mess this up. He's laying in front of the computer, so sometimes when I start talking, he thinks I'm talking to him, and he messes up the program. So let's try and answer Lester's question. So Lester at I'm a Survivor Sanctuary put out a video, said he has lots of questions about blankets and stalls and all kind of stuff. It's kind of funny. I went to the first answer, and somebody said. I can tell you what Rick will say. No stalls, no blankets. However, I have had accident both actually run in shelter stalls, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so I just got to the part where it said, I know what Rick's gonna say. Well, she may know what I'm gonna say, but she may not understand why I say it. And that's why when people repeat things or give advice saying, Rick said, they don't know how to fully explain it on why and put it in context, and they just make a statement like, I hate blankets, or I hate pink, or I hate women, or I hate stalls, or I hate whatever. Now, if they say I hate bits, they're probably right. I would agree with that. If they say I hate spurs, I would agree with that. If they said I hate leaving halters on horses when you're not with them, and actually moving or using the halter, then they would probably be right. So I don't mind those things, but to say he would say no stalls and no blankets, that's not necessarily true. So let's hear what Lester has to say about his questions.
I'm making a video asking for help.
Good old Lester. At least he asked for help. I'm surprised he still asked for help because I don't read his comments and I don't know how many people try and help him. But a lot of times when you ask the horse community for help, you will get people who think they know. People who don't know what they don't know, and they will try to help, but they give really bad advice because they're only repeating what they've heard or what they've seen. And there's so much wrong in the horse world, especially at barns, that doing what a lot of people do is not always good.
I need help from people who have horses. Okay, let me rephrase that. There's an expression in the horse community that says there are horse people and there's people who have horses.
And that's really good. And I'm glad he clarified that. And I'm glad that he's learning and understanding that. By the way, he did this little burnt thing on a wood. I think that was pretty cool. He showed in this clip. I'll probably skip through it because I just want to get to his questions and answers. But he burnt this wood pretty cool. Good job, Lester. I like that.
So I'm asking help from the people who know horses, not just those who have horses, because everyone knows that you can have a horse and not really know your horse. Ask these questions. I did not jot things down to talk about before I just start rambling on. Gore, for his help down here, and so I will also forward this video to him. Saved the money to have these four horse stalls built here under.
Okay, so let's take a look at some of his horse stalls that he's having built. And again, the time to do your research is before you invest all this money. So he's kind of going a little backwards here. He either took advice or designed this or took someone else's design or, just because somebody builds barns don't necessarily mean they're horse people. They just build either what people want or, and I don't know what the planning went through in this process. But when you have shelter like this, I don't know. A big thing is which way is this facing and which way does the wind come? Now, where I'm at, the wind usually always comes from the north or northwest. So if you'll notice in my shelter, I have a wall on the north side and on the west side because I want to block that wind. Even in the summer, when the wind is blowing really bad and it's dry, getting out of that wind will help stop, a horse from dehydrating. He gets in shade, but even if he's in shade and you've got a 15 mile an hour or 20 mile an hour wind like Texas has every day, when it blows that heat through, it whips the moisture off of a horse and it can help dehydrate him. So, I don't know which side his wind comes from and whether this faces north or south. People that watch him may know, but that's a consideration on you want to wall in that north wind and west wind if you're where I'm at, where he's at. I'm assuming the jet stream and his weather pattern is probably about the same because he's just west of me in Houston. So, And again, same way with the stalls. When you have all this open area here on stalls, this creates wind that comes in. And if you have shavings or hay, it blows it. And then the horse breathes it. And then it gets in his eyes and it gets in his ears. And all that can cause problems. So, and look, I mean, look, fair disclosure, I'm not a big stall guy. I don't think you should never use them. They're nice to have to separate a horse, to feed, maybe to doctor a horse, maybe to help a sick or old horse. But to me, stalls in general are bad for horses. Now, I don't just say that. I have reasons on why I think they're bad for horses. They create stall vices. They create cribbing where horses chew. They create wind sucking where horses wind suck and try it because they get bored. They create pacing. They wear down horses' hooves. They cause problems with horse hooves because they walk in circles. It mentally stagnates a horse's mind when he's locked in a stall. So all those things are bad for horses, which are caused by stalls. It also forces a horse to stand in his urine and poop and feces, which is not good for the horse. It increases thrush. It increases bacteria. So all those things are bad for a horse. A horse doesn't get exercise. He doesn't have commitment. These stalls are all fully enclosed. I like stalls to where a horse can at least stick his head out and either nose with another horse or interact with people or feel like he's not in a cage. So having an area where a horse can stick his head out is better if you have a stall, in my opinion. I don't like jail cells. I don't like being in a jail cell, and I'm pretty sure horses don't like being in a jail cell. Remember, horses are claustrophobic. That's why they don't like horse trailers. That's why they don't like to be trapped. That's why they get nervous when they get trapped or forced into small, dark, confined areas where they can't run. Horses feel safest when they're in open areas where they can run. Their fight, flight, and their speed is their safety. So they like to graze in open areas, and they like to be in areas where they can run and feel like they can defend themselves and protect themselves. Stalls take all that away. So, lots of bad things about stalls. Now, do they have a purpose? Sure. If he left these doors open and allowed the horses to come in and out as they wanted, I think that's great. I don't think they would spend much time in there. I also think that he needs to block the wind on probably two sides of the stall. Otherwise, he's going to have whatever footing he puts down here, whether it's sawdust, shavings, hay, whatever. It blows up. And not only does it blow up, but when the horses are in here and they poop and urine and that, if you're not cleaning a lot, then the horses have to smell it. And then they have to breathe it. And then they'll try and eat the hay when they get bored, because when horses get bored, they like to nibble because they're grazing animals. Therefore, they like to chew and nibble, you know, 22 hours out of the day because they only sleep about 2 hours a day. So when you lock up them in a stall, mentally and everything shuts down and they get bored. So that's why they start chewing on wood, chewing on bars, wearing down their teeth, eating hay that's soaked in urine and feces, because they just want to do something with their mouth because they're trapped and they're caged. So that's just the stall thing. Let's get to his questions.
Under, what we're calling our hay barn. This is where I stack my hay and to keep it out of the weather until I feed it. You know.
Okay, so stacking hay, I've been through this issue and everyone else has. At least this hay is off the ground and he's on wood. That's good. People have told me to lay cardboard or a tarp before I put my mat, because that helps the moisture. Concrete tends to create moisture, and you can see the wet spots in the concrete, especially if it's wet on the ground, etc. So it will cause this seeping of moisture, and it comes up and it will cause your hay to mold. This hay right here that's laid on concrete, man, I would absolutely put a tarp down before I put this hay on the concrete. Because I think this, when you pick up those hay bales, you're going to notice that it's very moist. Now, again, cows can handle moldy hay and round bales better than horses. A horse will colic, a cow's got a few stomachs, so that'll help. Let's get to this question. Sorry, I'm rattling on.
You know, throughout the course of the winter. And so what I'm trying to do today is figure out what I'm doing wrong, what I'm doing right.
So I can't tell if these stalls are concrete and this is just footing, or if he just concreted his horse stalls. A lot of horse stalls, if he wants to move this, maybe later as he grows, I would consider moving these stalls to a ground that I had good horse footing, like decomposed granite, or maybe that stuff that I just put down, that concrete base, it's holding up really well. A lot of people will make their stalls ground so it absorbs urine, so you can add ground and you can remove ground, so you can place the mats over ground, because mats over concrete is some cushioning, but mats over concrete is still much harder on a horse to stand than mats over ground. So even though you have pounded ground or granite or decomposed granite is really good for horses because it's water absorbent, it doesn't wash away, and if it's applied correctly and packed with a lot of water, it becomes a really good, good solid footing that the horses don't wear down. And when it does wear down a little bit, you just add a little on top and you repack it and you just keep adding to it. Which is why I think stalls are a little bit better if they're over ground instead of concrete. So one possible solution is if you improve another area and you build another shelter or cover, maybe build the cover and don't concrete where the horses stand. You can concrete where you walk and roll and move, but where the horses are at and you're going to put your mats, keep it a solid footing. Good pounded dirt, concrete base, a road base, what they call, which seems to be pretty cheap, is cheaper than decomposed granite. And then you can put some decomposed granite on top of it. There's a lot of footings that you can use where mats and that footing will do better. Because he gets into cleaning here, and when you have concrete, I've dealt with this in the military. When we'd raise dogs, we'd build new kennels and we would put concrete kennels, and no matter what coating we put on this concrete, what epoxy coating we put, the urine and feces would rot it away. And they finally got some good epoxy that worked, but there was still the issue of getting the urine out of the area. And when you have urine over concrete, it just sits and ferments and causes bacteria. So if he would have planned a little bit better, I would have suggested he puts a drain in each stall, so when he hoses it and a horse poops and pees, he can rinse it and he would have a drain in the middle that would go out. If you go to a vet's office and he has a nice setup at my vet's office, his floor is concrete, then he's got a nice good hard rubber coating which gives good traction for the horse's hooves even when it's wet. And then he's got drains, and his floor is meant to always kind of flow to the drains. So anytime he has a horse bleeding or infection or pooping or peeing in there, he simply drags in a hose and he squirts it. It goes down the drain. The floor is clean, and you don't have that stagnant bacteria. Lester, man, I'm sorry, bud, but this is just a really nightmare of a design because of the mats and the concrete and the drainage issues. You're going to have a continued issue. So long term, you know, live and learn. Hey, we all do stupid shit when we're doing this. And, you know, I would probably consider covering another shelter. You can make these open. You can even take out the center wall and make this a big, large holding stall to where you could put maybe two horses that get along and they would have a lot of room to move. But let me get back to the questions. Here we go.
Right with my horse stalls. And so question number one. I'm not that big of a doofus. I know that I need to have these mats laid down for the horses because they can't stand on concrete all night long. I bought enough mats, but as you can see, this one over here, well, these two need to be cut to lay in here. I do not know how to...
Okay, so cutting mats, good freaking luck, bud. I've tried everything, and... the things that I haven't tried that might work is maybe putting a saw, like a little skill saw, a handsaw, and putting it very short, draw a line, and then run the saw straight over the line to where you only cut like a quarter of an inch, and then go back and lower the blade maybe another quarter of an inch. Go over the same line again. That way it won't bind up and you're removing wax and things. I haven't tried that. I haven't tried one of those vibrating cutters. It's a little hand tool. Like when you're cutting, if you're cutting at the bottom, you slide it on the concrete and you push it forward. It's got a flat blade and it vibrates really quick and it actually cuts through wood, they might make a vibrating cutter that will cut straight down to where you can come straight down on top of and cut. Most people, before they design their stalls, they know that most stalls are either 4x6 or 3x5, I think is the two type of stall mats. So when you make your stall, you make it to where if it's 4x6, you either make it 12 feet so you can get 3 4s, or you can turn sideways and get 2 6s and get your 12 feet. So if you had a stall that was 12x12, looking at this, I can't tell if this stall is square or if it's long. I think you made it rectangular instead of square. If you made a 12x12 stall, your mats would automatically fit. So if there's a way to readjust these stalls, I think you'd be easier readjusting your stalls by a 12x12 than you would be trying to cut mats. But good luck, and I cannot help you on that one. Next question.
How to cut these things, because I've tried a skill saw, and I'm these things skill saw. Not lay in here the way I want them to. I do want to leave a little bit of space around the edges so that I can help, you know, make it easier for cleanup.
So I noticed at the front earlier, it looks like this metal is not touching the ground. So when he hoses this out, he'll be able to squirt poop and urine and clean out so bacteria and stuff doesn't clog up here. If that isn't the case, I would put some, what do you use when you're squaring a door? Shims. I would shim this up a little bit and raise it to where there was a good quarter of an inch gap. Now, when you put a quarter of an inch gap, you also have wind blowing in the bottom. So that can be problematic unless you put a wind block on one side and allow for the water and drainage to come out. I don't know if this wood has been treated. If it hasn't been treated, it's going to get wood rot from all the hosing. It's going to get wood rot from horses pooping in a corner or peeing and urine splattering on it, etc. Again, stalls are just problematic. They're not good for horses. I don't like them. The best stalls are the ones that are left open, and when horses want to go in, they get to go in. Or if you use them for a temporary doctoring, medical, separate for food, and then get them out. The less time a horse spends in a stall, I think the healthier mentally and physically it is, better for the horse.
We're going to get to that cleanup question a little bit later. So question number one, what does someone was the best to cut these darn things? If they do, the guys that we were blessed to find to come out and build these things for us, I mean, they did an amazing job. Oh, by the way,
the stalls do look nice and they did do a good job, but again, they're not square, so it's hard to measure the mats and get them. These mats are freaking great for everything, and I love these mats. I mean, I put them in walkways. I put them over my drain in the winter because it keeps, I don't want my pipes to freeze, and I have a turnoff. And so I put one of these mats over that square thing in the winter, and it really keeps it from freezing and keeps the cold from going down on top of it. So these mats are just, they've got wonderful uses. You've seen them out in my tie area where I give baths, etc. But again, I think they work better over ground and not over concrete.
Wait, I burnt the wood myself. Thumbs up to Lester.
Dude, that was cool. Excited about you doing did that. So dude, I that's burnt, a great idea. So I love wood. his burning wood.
That was me and Jamie's doing right there. But here's my question. How in the world do you clean these things? When I do clean up in here, how do I clean? And I'll tell you why, because I've cleaned this morning. Yet, as you can see, this is not really clean.
Yeah, it's not clean. And unfortunately, when you get mats like this, see, if this was on ground, what you're seeing here would disperse and dissipate into the ground. The water would wash it into the ground, and you would have more of a natural thing going on underneath. But when you make concrete and metal and plastic, and now you add urine, feces, and water, it's just a breed. It's like a petri dish. You're doing a scientific experience on growing bacteria.
I can't bring the water hose in here because the weld on these this framing goes right along the bottom of the concrete, so there's no space for water to...
Okay, so there isn't a space. I thought there was a space, and I thought maybe the mats were blocking that space. I would just put some shims underneath there and either jack it up, get a little jack, and jack it up and place, you know, metal bolts every 2 or 3 feet, and then set it back down to where it leaves a air gap. One, air will get in there and dry this out. Moisture, again, breeding ground, bacteria, bad hay. And what a lot of people do is they'll just throw covering over this so they don't have to see this. But it's still here, and it's still fermenting. And now you're adding hay and something on our footing on top of it to increase that bacteria growth. So a lot of issues with concrete and underneath horse stalls. I think if you build another shelter, I would move these stalls to where there's ground underneath, put a good footing, and then put mats over the ground. And then that way you can remove the mats once in a while. You can put down some lime or DG or not DG, not decomposed granite, crap. Other stuff that helps clear out bacteria that will go into the ground and get rid, and it makes the ground hard and it gets rid of bacteria. And I think lime is one, and there's something else that I can't think of, another one that they use. But again, I think rubber over ground is much better than rubber over concrete.
You can't push stuff out using water pressure. I tried to get over here on the backside and blow everything out using air pressure, you know, my air blower. But if you're blowing against the wind, the stuff comes right back in your face. Not to mention, it also blows all this wet gunk all up along the side of your stall and over.
Yeah, and not only is it blowing it now, these are new and you've just started. Wait 6 months or a year, because all these little things are going to start gathering, and then they become mold pockets and you have mold growth. I mean, it's just, it's a compounding issue. If you're not going to keep the horses in there all the time and they just come in to eat and doctor, I think this is manageable, because you put some footing down, they're not peeing and pooping in there. Horses don't like to pee and poop because it splatters, especially on rubber mats. Even with footing, they just don't like to stand in their own urine. And then after they, you know, a horse stands in here, if he urinates here, you've just cut your stall in half. So the horse has to go hide in the other half of the stall to stay out of his urine. And then if he urines on the other side, now you've cut their stall in fourths. And then sooner or later, the horse has no place to stand but in his urine and in his feces. And then he starts ignoring that, and it becomes normal for him to stand in urine and feces. And then you get foot problems and thrush and all these other issues.
Over time, that's going to get very messy. That's going to be really sloppy. So here, I would not think that would be this. Given the okay by you folks, I told Jamie, I says, tonight, I think I may lay down a tarp. This may be so stupid, but I think I might lay down a tarp, maybe two, to cover the floor. And then cover the top of the tarp with a little bit of pine shavings to keep it along the ground. And then tomorrow morning when I come out to clean, just roll the tarps up, drag them out, empty them, shake them.
Okay, so the tarp idea, I mean, that might work. I think the horse is going to tear holes in the tarp, especially if your mats aren't to the edge, because when a horse hoof hits that tarp on this sharp edge here, it's going to tear your tarp. And you're going to have holes in your tarp, and over time, your tarps are going to dry rot, and they're not going to be as strong. So then when you get in there, over time, when urine gets on the tarps and feces gets on the tarps, it's going to start wearing and breaking them down, and they're not going to last very long, or they're going to tear when you're pulling them out. But I mean, that's an option. It wouldn't be my best option for this right now. I'm not sure what a good option is. First, you got to figure out how to get mats in there, and you may just end up wasting mats. You know, slide this one all the way over here, overlap this one, and then overlap a third one, and then just overlap them, which is going to make a very uneven ground for the horses to walk on. But if you put shavings on top, it's going to make a cleaning nightmare. There's not really a good solution to this issue.
And, you know, get everything out of here that way. Chewing on the tarps, I don't think they would do that. They're not goats. But that was one idea that I...
They will chew on it if they're locked in a stall. They will chew on anything because, again, their mind goes numb and they get bored, and they're used to eating and creating saliva and just nibbling on grass. They're grazing animals. So, and the only way that they really communicate and feel and test things is through their mouth and nose. So they will eventually end up chewing or tearing or being bored when sucking. Also, if you lay a tarp down and you lay hay, they may accidentally bite it and chew it. I mean, I can't really see that happening. They usually pull their hay up with their lips, not necessarily their teeth, unless they're pulling it from the ground.
That I thought about a simple solution. Something else, and I hate to even mention this. You know, this concrete slab that we had poured, this is not cheap. And so we were...
Concrete's out of control in Texas. When I did my barn, which is 1,200 square feet, it's 30 by 40, 40 feet long and 30 feet wide. So 30 by 40, 3 times 4 is 12, is 1,200 square feet. I think it was 6,500 for my slab. And I thought that was kind of high, but people are telling me now that same slab would cost well over 10, maybe 12 grand. So concrete is definitely not cheap. Now, if this is all concrete under here with all this hay, it looks like he's got a lot of hay in here. I'm not even sure what this is. What is this for, birds? I don't know what the hell's going on here. Is this for goats or? I'm not talking to you, monkey.
Blessed to have saved the money from the folks. Thought about maybe, this is going to sound horrible, but maybe chipping the concrete out? Maybe, seriously, chiseling?
Well, and that may not be, if I don't know if you can chisel out a hole and a tunnel. There may be a concrete drill bit that you could get a nice drill bit and drill down and then drill through the side to make some sort of drain. The problem is if you don't have like a 2-inch hole, whatever feces and dirt and sand and hay and mud from the horse's hooves and poop is going to clog up any small holes. So if you're going to do it, you need a pretty large hole that, you know, you can put some water through and force anything so it doesn't get clogged up. Again, that's going to be problematic. Again, we're trying to come up with a lot of fixes because it wasn't thought out or planned or whoever designed or, you know, look, none of these problems are like new. Every horse owner or barn has been through these problems. So you really got to do, and Lester says in this, look, he's got other jobs. Both him and Jamie, I guess, work. I'm not sure. I think he's a teacher. I'm not sure what Jamie does, but I think they both have jobs. So when you're trying, I mean, look, taking care of a few horses is freaking a full-time job. But these guys have cows, goats, sanctuary. I mean, they're taking care of a lot of animals. So having a full-time job and trying to get up to speed and an expert on everything from building barns to building stalls to horse care to horse manage to goat manager. I mean, they're doing multiple animals. So it's not easy, but like with horses, if you take the time you take and the slow way is the fast way, more planning on the front end would have helped this. And I'm not trying to beat him up on this. I mean, shit, it is what it is. It's usable, it's functional, and you can make it work. But it's not going to be easy. And it's going to take more time and effort now because, you know, just like I say with horses, if you try to take a shortcut or you try to do something fast, you end up redoing it over and over again with a horse because you didn't take the slow way at the first part.
Bring the concrete out here onto the ground, and that way I could bring in a water hose and kind of power spray everything in one direction.
So another option, instead of drilling into the concrete, would be to cut this metal bar, which may not be too bad, and then just simply put a gap right here, a 1-inch gap on this pipe, and remove, you know, 4 inches of this pipe right here. Then you don't cut the concrete. That's a little bit easier. And now you have a good pathway. That doesn't fix all this crap storing and molding underneath everywhere else, but it does give you a drain point by removing, you know, 2 or 4 inches of pipe here. And now you have a little gateway here that it'll still keep the wood off the ground, but you'll still have a 4-inch gap there that you can score it out. That might be the easier fix.
To where it drains out, you know, under through the concrete, under the welded pipe here. Yeah, I would love the mats and how I'm going to cut those. I've also asked about cleanup and any tips to that third question, which was, sorry, my hands are so dirty. Guys, I've been clean. I've been muck deep.
Oh, poor Lester. You can't keep your damn hands clean with horses.
Mucking the horse stalls. Is that a word? That's not one of my questions. The third thing was the type of bedding. I've heard.
Okay, bedding. He asked about bedding, and bedding is, again, one of those things that if you don't have a horse locked in there, you don't need to worry about that. But if you have a horse locked in there, which is better? Wood shavings. I think wood shavings work pretty well. The problem with wood shavings is it draws moisture out of the horse's hoofs, and it makes the horse's hoof dry and crack. So anytime a horse is standing in wood shavings for any length of time, they usually get cracks, and it compromises the hoof integrity. And when you get cracks, it makes it easier for bacteria, dirt, mold, and other things to get in there and create thrush and abscesses, etc. Again, keeping a horse in a stall, it doesn't matter. It's just so many negatives that come with it. Temporary for feeding, separating, medical, I get it. There's a use. Keeping a horse in here because it makes you feel good, because you think they're safe, because you think you're doing them a favor, it goes back to saying a child wears a coat when the mother is cold. Horse owners that want horses locked up do it because it makes them feel good. It does not help the horse, in my opinion.
Heard that hay is a no-no, but it's possible that maybe a pine shaving, pine bark. And if I do use pine bark, how thick should it be, and how often should I have to change it out?
Well, you're going to answer that by when you put it in there on how long the horse is in there. The longer the horse is in there, the more they're going to pee and poop. The more they pee and poop, the more you got to change it. The more you got to change more, the more it soaks and evaporates into everything. When you get footing in here, you're raising the footing on top of these mats to where it's going to be up to the wood. So now when a horse pees, the footing will soak it up, and it will be soaked against the wood, and it causes decomposition and breakdown issues with that. I don't know if he had another question or not. Let me pause and see if he had another question. Okay, so here he's talking about how much should a horse poop in a stall, and we get into blankets.
Inside the stalls, and that way it'll allow the cows and the donkeys to eat in peace. If you don't already know this, the horses...
What the hell are these horses doing with blankets on? So, I think he gets into the blanket issue here. And my view on blankets. Let me tell you why I don't like blankets. And it's not because I don't like them personally. I don't like them because they're not good for the horse. I base my opinions on what's good for the horse. There's a thing that's called thermoregulation that horses go through. And if you look up the term horse thermoregulation, I've got a nice article where a woman did a great article. And I think she was a vet or did something at a college or something. But she did a great thing on why blankets mess up horses. Natural thermal regulation. Horses have the ability, like most animals with fur, to stick their fur up to gather air or to let air through. They also sweat. Horses, I think, are the only other land animal besides humans that sweat through their skin. No other animal sweats through their skin except horses and humans. I think that's a correct fact. I could be wrong. So because of that, when you put a blanket on a horse, here's the problems that blankets create. It traps moisture and air, it traps bacteria, it traps sweat and salt, it stops airflow. When you have trapped moisture, you get rain rot, fungi, horsehair problems, bacteria starts growing. There's all kind of issues from having a blanket on a horse, especially long term. Now, is there a time for a blanket? Sure. I put a blanket when it got -6 here because we don't normally get that cold. My horses were doing fine when it was in the teens. This is the first time I put blankets on my horses since I've been in Texas because it just doesn't get that cold here. It gets below freezing. Horses are fine. There's a lady that's got a -36, I think, in Minnesota, and her horses don't have blankets. -36. I was like, are you kidding me? So, her horses are used to it because they can thermoregulate, because they grow fur. If you take a horse from a sunny area and you drive to the mountains and there's snow, a horse will start growing hair almost immediately, and he will start regulating that he's in a colder climate, and his body will start adjusting. Most people who put blankets on horses do it because it makes them feel better and they think they're protecting and helping the horse. Actually, it normally hurts the horse unless it's an exception to the rule. It's a very cold snap and they haven't had a chance to adjust. A horse is old and it doesn't grow hair efficiently. A horse has been shaved by humans for a stupid show and they don't have fur, so they can't warm themselves. So now they need a blanket to keep them warm. Another problem with blankets is horses will roll because it makes them sweaty and itchy because they're not used to having clothes on. So it's irritating. It's like you putting on a wool sweater against your skin. You're going to itch and it's going to make you irritable and you're going to want to roll and itch and scratch and you're not going to be comfortable. That's what horses do when you put a blanket on. So they like to roll. When they roll in urine, feces, mud, water. The blanket gets wet and it defeats the purpose. So it always creates problems with blankets. I noticed that they put the legs straps on the horses on each side. I'm not a big blanket person, but I know most people who do blankets will cross these straps and it stops the blankets from moving left to right. So if you're going to put a blanket on, adjust the straps to where you can run one strap under this strap and then hook it up. And it keeps them cross and it keeps the blanket supposedly from moving left or right. Now, I'm not a blanket expert. I don't use blankets a lot. I've used blankets maybe 3 or 4 times in my life. So, I'm not really a blanket expert, but I do know that they're not good for horses for a lot more reasons than they are good for horses. And there is exceptions to the rules. Again, a horse that is sick and maybe shivering, a horse that isn't thermal regulating, a horse that has been kept in a stall like these idiots in the shows, they leave lights on and stalls all the time. So the horses think the days aren't getting longer. Therefore, they don't grow their winter coat. Therefore, the lazy owners don't have to groom or brush them. And so they trim their horses and then they keep the lights on all the time. So it tricks the horse's body into thinking that the days are not getting shorter. Therefore, winter is coming. Therefore, the horses don't grow their winter hair. Another reason I don't like lights. People think I've got an anti-light fetish because I hate lights around horses at night. Horses' night vision is very light sensitive. It takes a long time for them to get it. I don't like lights. I don't like any lights. I don't like flashlights. I don't like stall lights. I don't like anything that affects my horse's night vision. So, anyway, that's my blanket spill. Let's see what
we're doing. Horses have a really bad habit of, well, I'm just going to call them the playground bullies. The horses have a horrible habit of running the other animals off of their food. On the farm, higher.
Okay, horses are usually higher in most animals, most prey animals, because they're food protective. So they usually will establish dominance. So if you try and feed horses with other animals, horses will get first choice, they get best choice, and they will keep other people away from it. Sometimes they will even dominate a water. So I've seen some horses dominate the water. They'll stand by the water and won't let any other horse in to get a drink to show their dominance that they can do it. I usually correct it if I see it and I run that horse off because I don't want it to become a habit. But I don't know why the hell these horses have got blankets on. It doesn't look that cold out there, but it could be.
Hierarchy of these farm animals, the horses are up, or they're up here. And even though, you know, we have techs.
Another problem with blankets is if you use one horse blanket on another horse without cleaning and disinfecting it, you transfer microbes and any skin problems or any bacteria or lice, now you transfer it to another one. If you take a blanket off a horse and you didn't notice it had rain rot or some sort of bacterial fungal infection going on and it got on the blanket, when you use that blanket on another horse, you have now transferred that and you've doubled your problem. Now you have two horses with that.
Our world famous longhorn, and we have all kinds of amazing animals. We have Moo, the steer, who weighs well over 2,000 pounds. I mean, these are huge animals, yet they come below the horses. It's not...
Even the donkey has a look at his little
dude. The size of the animal, it's the attitude of the animal that determines how they eat.
Okay, having the stall doors open, notice the horses are curious. They're going to go in. Even though I think if you're going to leave a door open, you want it wide open instead of half open. You always want to predict problems. If you have a horse, if you leave this even 6 inches, they're going to stick their head and try to open it. And then they will ski, as soon as they can squeeze through, they will. They don't know to open it all the way so it doesn't get caught on the blanket and trap them and scare them and spook them and tear it up. So if your stall doors are open, they should be fully open. If they're closed, they need to be fully closed.
And so the horses are known to bully themselves and run everything else around. And so,
okay, it's not bullying in horses. Remember, we don't want to label horses with bad names or negative names like spooky, mean, bully, etc. When you use those terms, horses get labels, and it's not really that. This horse blanket looks really long. When this horse poops, it's going to be pooping and urinating all on the inside of this blanket, and it's going to be hard, soaked, etc. So this blanket really looks long. Not only are the leg lengths really long, they just appear to be.
I do not want to feed
really
the horses out here anymore. I want to.
Okay, this blanket looks a little small for this horse because it's coming up over the hips, and this kind of should be pretty much at the tail dock. But again, if you're doing it to keep a horse warm, Buddy outgrew his blanket, and I noticed when I put it on, since I moved here, either the blanket shrunk or Buddy grew. And his blanket was a little small, but it still covered his back, kept the snow and wind off, and helped him when it was -6. So I was okay with that.
Bring them in and let them eat in peace, which allows these guys to eat in peace.
Okay, so it sounds like he's bringing them in to eat in peace, but if you're just going to do it for eating, then they need to be out again. And once they get in a routine, they'll know what stall is theirs. They'll go in their own stall. You probably don't even need to shut the door. They'll eat, and when they're finished, they'll come back out here and roam. And then he can just let them in. You know, once he, horses are pretty good on a routine. If you do the same way each time, man, they'll pick it up. They like to know what's going to happen before it happens.
But if I leave the horses in the stall overnight.
Bad move. I would not do that. They don't need to be stalled. It's not necessary. You create bad habits, you lock the horse up when they don't need to be locked up, and you're going to create stall vices, urine, bacteria, hoof problems, respiratory problems. Even though you have wind in here, whatever footing you have, when the wind comes through, it's going to blow it up. The horses are going to be breathing that. It's not good for their nose. They're going to be sneezing more. They're going to have runny nose. You get lung issues, respiratory infections. I mean, I just can't believe the number of problems that come with stalls and horses, and yet locking horses up in stalls still seem to be pretty popular.
You know, that might be another question. Should I leave the horses in the stalls over summer stalls? They're not winter blankets. Man, we got blankets for the donkeys, for the baby donkeys, for the...
Oh, look, it was pink. How pretty.
The horses, and we've been so blessed to have received these blankets. I have them here kind of air dry right now. But I have a lot of questions about them because our comments on the videos have been full of people saying that horses don't need blankets.
Well, your commenters, I would agree with them, and they don't, and they create more problems. Again, when humans try to help horses, remember, horses in the wild, BLM, the government is trying to kill wild Mustangs every freaking day because they breed and do so well when humans aren't involved. Nobody is blanketing their horses in the wild. Wild horses don't get hoof care. They don't usually live as long. They become wormy and they die of diseases, etc. But they breed freaking too well when humans stay out of it. Humans create all these problems. Humans with horses are like government. They come in saying, we're going to help. You need us. We're here to help you. And all they do is create problems, spend money that don't need to be spent on things, and they end up creating more problems that they have to spend more money on to fix because they want to come in and help. So anyway, I think that's all his questions, and I'm at almost 45 minutes here.
Saying so. At what temperature should one remove the blanket?
Okay, so again, Lester, I think you're asking questions in absolutes. Like, there's an absolute temperature on when to remove a blanket. And there's really no absolutes in horses. Every answer in horses is usually, it depends. It depends on the age. It depends on the wind. It depends on the weather. It depends on whether the blanket needs to come off. It depends on whether the horse is hot, if the temperature changes. Look, I don't think horses need a blanket in the first place. So a bigger problem with blankets is people that put them on don't take them off. I drive around here and it's freaking 60 degrees. And I see these horses hiding in the shade in the corner trying to they're just sweating to death because some owner put it on because they thought it got 40 degrees last night. You know, it gets down to 30 here and then it'll get 65 during the day. So we can have up to 30 to 35 degree changes between night and daytime here in Texas. And the horses can deal with those when you allow them to naturally thermoregulate to where they can fluff their hair up, they can dry, they can go out, they can roll in some water to cool off, and then they can dry off pretty quickly and stay warm. So anytime you get blankets involved, you're messing up their thermoregulation. When should you take a blanket off? Well, the answer should probably in Texas be probably never, because you should never put it on. Again, rare circumstances where a horse may need help.
Because, you know, last week we had such horrible temperatures here. It did not go above freezing for the entire week. And so what I would do is
freezing is fine for horses. Like I said, there's people in Norway and Sweden and Switzerland that they don't blanket their horses. And I'm like, holy cow, man, they have negative sub-zero temperatures there and they don't blanket their horses. So for me to blanket my horse, -6 was my threshold. And as soon as it got out of single digits, I took my blanket off. And my horses were absolutely fine. They never shivered once. And they were pretty freaking happy when I took the blankets off. Even though I thought I was helping them at -6, they seemed pretty freaking happy. And they went out and rolled immediately when I took the blanket off. Why? Because they wanted to get that bacteria mashed down, sweaty hair. They wanted to fluff it up. They wanted to get their natural scent back. They wanted to get their hair feeling like it was normal, maybe get blood flow from the blanket hanging on them, whatever. So, all right, I'm going to end that there because I'll keep rattling on. It's 46 minutes. Hopefully you guys got something out of it. Lester's going to use, he said he may use parts of this. Look, fair use. I don't care. He can use all of it, parts of it. I don't care. I don't want anything. He don't have to worry about copyright from me. So don't sweat it. And good luck, Lester. And hopefully I answer some of your questions and then we'll read the comments, because my commenters will be telling me how I got it wrong and they will be giving alternative opinions, either supporting me or not supporting me, which is okay. I mean, that's what I think YouTube should be. All right, we'll end that there. Y'all have a good day.